Well, I wanted to get into woodworking because I started building shelves when I was in college, needing little things for a bookshelf or needing little wooden adapters, and started working with the hand tools and building whatever furniture we needed to sort of make our apartment a little more living. The more I got into woodworking, the more I realized that there are some things you have to do with hand tools, and to a lot of skills along that line were more efficient using hand tools. And then I got an interest in collecting some of the hand tools and playing around more. And that sort of led to doing a lot more work with total hand tools, just hand planes and augers and chisels. And as I got into wood turning more and more, I kind of went backwards on that as well, trying to play with the spring pole lays and the treadle lays the way it was originally done. This is I'm trying to build the world's smallest goblet, and if you can see the little yellow one right there, that's shorter than a penny is laying on its side. It's less than a 1/16 of an inch. I've just made new tools, so I should be able to make a really small one here shortly. Traditionally, what we did, of course, is we got a green log, and you do what's called riving the log, or splitting the log this way. By riving the log, we would hammer down through it. What that does is follows the grain, so the grain of the wood runs the full length of the piece of wood. If you take a piece of wood that has some curly grain in it, there's a little bit right here, if you cut around that with a saw, sometimes the grain will actually run out through the edge of the piece and it'll break. And by having the grain run all the way down through the wood, it won't break. So that's the advantage of riving a piece. So what we do is we split it off, and then I split these into to whatever size I need to make my legs. And you can see that pops off just where the grain goes, so I know how the grain's running. That's close. Then what we do is we go to a shaving horse. Because it takes a very long time to put this on the lathe and knock off all these corners, it's much faster to go to the shaving horse. And what we do is we take it down to square first. Back in the original days, they did this. They had what they called a bodger. This guy would travel around, and what he would do is he'd go into a town, and all he'd do is make chair legs. He'd leave his chair parts up to the other person, and they would make as many as 300 legs in 1 week. You kind of square it off first, then you go back and make it hexagon shaped, depending on what you want it to look like. It's real fat in the middle there. This one actually came from my grandfather. Great-grandfather, actually, had that one. I was fortunate enough in that over the years since I started doing traditional woodworking, my family's gone through and pulled out some of the things the relatives had from way back. Draw knives were pretty common on farms to be able to shape all kinds of things, make new axe handles, whatever. But yeah, I built this. I don't know if you can actually buy one. I have to build them. There's a guy from England named Don Weber who now lives in Kentucky that'll teach you how to build a shaving horse and a lathe. So basically you just find a good stance, and the original, of course, would have made their own tools. I didn't make these, I bought them. I'm learning blacksmithing so I can learn that. But and it goes pretty slow out toward that end where that dry wood was. It's always a lot slower right here where it's really rough. If you take a little bit longer to make it more hex shaped, it goes a lot faster. Well, you take calipers to make it duplicate things. Usually you'll put another piece out here that you can look at and measure. And you'll simply measure the diameters and take your calipers and slide it over and turn that part down until it's the right diameter. And then you'll turn the high point down, the low points, and you have all the high and low points set. And you'll have the distances marked off, usually with a pencil line.
And then you just simply try to watch that shape and try to turn the second piece the same shape. Because this lathe was built to be converted to a treadle lathe and into a motor lathe when I teach the history of wood turning. Normally you would have an A-frame built at the bottom and the string would go out there really far. So you'll notice now I'm getting about, there's one, two, about 2 1/4 revolutions per stomp. And if I extended that string way out there, I could probably get about 3 to 5 revolutions per push, which obviously would make it go a lot faster. Now what we do, well, we'll smooth that part off to get the kind of general shape that we want. We use what's called a skew, which is a much sharper tool and much cleaner cutting, and that gets rid of all those deep tool marks. You can see how that's getting a lot smoother now. And this was the tool marks from the other tool.
Big difference.
This one's called a roughing out gouge, and what the roughing out gouge does is basically just takes off a lot of wood fairly quickly, but it leaves marks. The spindle gouge, this would be for turning little details. I want to turn a cove or a bead or something, which I'll show you here in a minute. One thing I like about using these tools, because it's turning slowly, I get a better feel for how my tool's cutting and what it's cutting. Let's turn a little bead. We'll start it off, we'll turn what's called a cove detail. You see that on this I can control the speed very accurately, so I can really watch how the cut's happening. On a powered lathe, that's hard to do because it's very quick. We'll turn a couple of coves. We'll connect that with a bead in the middle. We call them head slappers. You'll think of some really neat idea. If I did this or I did that, it would be so cool. This would happen, and you'll find out later. You'll pick up a book, and back in the 1800s, some guy was doing the same thing. And that's part of why I read the old books, is determine so that I can learn techniques that somebody else may have used years ago, and I'm not just redeveloping or reinventing it. There we go. Well, that's how you turn a bead. Turn little coves depending on the shape and what you want. You go on and just continue shaping this chair leg or stool leg any way you want to make it.